want to start off with the same old road for miles and miles. If you've been hearing the same old voice at the same old lies, if you're trying to feel the same old holes inside, there's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need
hey guys,
freedom,
welcome to Big Love Radio. I'm your host, Joel Ashford, and we are having some camera issues, so I do have my lovely wife, Shanna, on the other end, and Tanisha, and even my son, Jamie's in the studio today. Say hello, Jamie. And as you can see, our special guest is Miss Natalie. Say hello, Miss Natalie.
Hello.
And man, we've got a powerful show for you guys tonight, but before we get started, we always want to open up in a word of prayer. So let's go ahead and bow our heads and we'll pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we just ask you to let your name be glorified tonight, Father God, and just allow the Holy Spirit to flow through Natalie to share her powerful testimony that I know there's someone out there that needs to hear. So, Father God, we just open up this show giving glory to you, Father God, and that your name may be glorified, and that there is somebody out there that is going to benefit from this powerful testimony in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen, guys. So, man, I just want to start off the show, Natalie, by saying thank you for coming on the show. I know you drove quite a ways to get here, and it's okay to talk in there. We're live.
Well, I didn't want to cut you off.
Oh, no. Go ahead. Cut me off, because I talk a lot.
I want to thank you guys for having me here. It is really an honor and a privilege.
Thank you, babe.
I'm so sorry.
Well, I appreciate it. And, you know, me and Shanna's had an opportunity, or I've had an opportunity, I think, to hear some of your testimony. I don't think Shanna was with us. Oh, yeah, she was.
The Pallage Unit.
We were at the Pallage Unit, and I know you shared part of it, but not all of it. And from what you told me, it's pretty amazing.
God's amazing.
God is a good God. And, you know, and Natalie, that's what our show's all about, is just lifting up the name of Jesus. And, you know, we do it in the prisons and we do it at church. And this show, my prayer when we were given this show was just to be able to go all over the world. You know, we have listeners in California. We just picked one up that was in Russia. And some of the DFW area. So we're on iHeartRadio, guys. We're on Spotify, and we're also on iTunes. So these podcast shows are worldwide. So you never know who's going to hear your testimony or some of the other testimonies that are on the show. So, we're going to go ahead and kind of give a praise report from this weekend. Were you at any units this weekend, or did you have a praise report
this
you wanted
weekend,
to share?
This weekend, I actually had a break.
Okay.
I just got back from doing a dog transport, actually, so
okay.
I was kind of resting. But
okay.
I had been in several times over the past month.
Great, great. Anything you want to share?
Get my Kleenex ready.
Yeah, yeah.
Every time I go in, it really is a blessing.
Amen.
And I never thought, first off, that the Lord would have put me in a men's prison. Because of everything that happened in the past.
Prison mm-hmm. ministry.
And
yeah, men's prison ministry, guys.
Prison ministry.
Yes. Let's get that straight.
Everything I had been through and the feelings that I had toward men. When I first went in, I was like, Lord, is this really where you want me to be? Are you sure? Are you sure? When we went to Pallage, I felt like a deer in headlights. And I kept saying, okay, don't show fear. Don't show fear. They're going to sense weakness.
Right.
And the moment that I stepped up there and spoke that very first word, I don't remember anything. The fear went away and the Holy Spirit just took over, and it was unbelievable.
Yeah. Isn't that amazing how when you do that, how that works?
Yeah. He showed up and showed off.
Always does. Amen. Amen.
Right.
But there was one particular evening that we went, and it was David Knight.
Mm-hmm.
It was my spiritual mama and daddy that went for the first time.
I remember hearing about that, yes.
And myself. So there was four of us that went to Pallage a few weeks ago. And I had everything prepared. You know, you prepare your message. You've got your notes ready. And the Lord always changes it up. But it's never what you intended it to be.
Right.
And I was sharing some of my testimony. And then the Lord said, I want you to share this little piece. And all it was sharing that I had been a victim of incest from the time I was 4 until the time I was 13. And afterwards, there was this elderly man in a wheelchair. And Daddy Mac had been talking to him, and Kelly and I were praying for another gentleman. And Daddy Mac taps me on the shoulder when we were finished, and he said, this one's for you. So I kneel down so that I could be eye level with him and really hear him. And right. He's just weeping and proceeding to say how he's so judged in there and how he's assaulted on a daily basis. And it's because of who he is and what he's done.
Yeah.
Mm.
And I asked him, I said, well, have you accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? And he said, yes, I have. I said, you asked him to forgive you of your sins? And he said, yes, I have. I said, then that's not who you are anymore.
Amen.
I said, you're a new creation in Christ. And he starts weeping a little bit more, and he says, yeah, but you don't understand. You don't understand what I've done and who I am. I said, look at me. And I said that 3 times because he wouldn't look at me in the eye.
Right.
And then finally the 3rd time he looks up, and the only way that I can explain, because human words can't express this, it felt like Jesus put me on. Yeah. Because I wasn't me, if that makes any sense.
Oh, of course.
And he said, I'm a sex offender and I'm a pedophile.
Mm.
There wasn't your flesh, especially sure. after going through something like that, your flesh would make a face or back away, be a little hesitant of that. There was nothing but pure, unconditional love for this man.
Amen.
Amen.
And he says, I don't know if I can be forgiven. And all I can remember is looking at this man and saying, you are forgiven. And he just let go. When I left, I was trying to process what happened because I couldn't understand why I didn't have some sort of reaction to that.
Right.
And the Lord ended up confirming it is I was the closest thing that this man had to sort of ask for that forgiveness because yeah. he couldn't ask forgiveness from his victims. But because of my testimony, just that little piece, mm-hmm. he approached me. And if I would have had any sort of human reaction, emotion, that man would not have truly believed that he was forgiven.
That's so true. That's awesome.
And that was a blessing.
That's so awesome, sister.
That was a blessing.
Amen. You know, if you guys are listening, well, I know you're listening or you wouldn't be on here. You wouldn't be paying attention to what I'm saying right now, but... you know, there's so many people out there that when we go into the prisons, Natalie, that, you know, when I talk to afterwards and they're like, oh, we could deal with anybody but a sex offender. We could deal with anybody but a pedophile. Those people should be killed. And, you know, it's just another sin. It really is another sin. And a lot of you guys, if you're listening, you may not believe me, but look it up. It's another sin. And, you know, the problem with the human race is that we try to judge our sins differently. Oh, well, he did this, but I only did this, and I'm only a sinner in this area. But sin is a sin is a sin, and you were sent that day for that man.
I know.
You know, I had a similar situation that happened like that one time where this guy was at Cofield, and he was always standing off from the class, and I finally went over there, and one of the guys said, man, Joel, you got to get on this guy, man. He's bashing the Holy Spirit, and he's doing this. So I'm like, dude, what's up? Why are you away from the class? He said, y'all don't want to care for me. Y'all don't care nothing about me. And y'all say you're Christians, but y'all don't love me. And I told the guys, I said, why don't y'all go away and just let me talk to this brother? And I said, why do you say that? I said, do you think we drive 150, 170 miles, get up at 2:30 in the morning because we don't love you guys? Oh, you may love them, but you don't love me. And I said, how do you know I don't love you? He said, because if you loved me, you'd help me find a place to parole to. So I said, well, I'd be glad to. What, when you getting out? And he said, no, but it's the charge. And I said, what'd you do? And he said, I'm a pedophile. And none of these Christian people will help me. And I had to tell him, you know, I said, it's not that we don't want to help you. And right when I said it, he said, and God doesn't want to help me. And I said, no, God wants to help you, or you wouldn't be here. You'd probably be dead in your sin, and he's forgiven you. He has forgiven you for what you've done. He said, then why won't anybody help me? And I said, it's not that we won't help you, and it's not that God hadn't forgiven you. It's that we still suffer the consequences of our sins.
Exactly.
And because of what you did, these halfway homes are in neighborhoods and by schools that they can't allow you to be there. It's not they don't want to help you. So, you know, and I said, I'll tell you what, I'll make some phone calls for you if you come sit back in class and pay attention. And he came back to class, and I went back a couple of times. And every time I went back, I took him the notes of the places I called for him. And he hugged me, and he said, man, Joel, you really do care. He said, nobody else has ever done this for me. And he's still in. He still had made parole. But when I go there, he always embraces me. And he's always in class. And, you know, we go in the prisons to reach the people that nobody else wants to work with.
Exactly.
And it's a calling. And you've been called, Natalie. We've all been called to do that. But I just wanted to share a powerful deal that happened with us. I went in with Brother Charles Fisher to the Estelle unit yesterday. And, you know, it's amazing how you get your messages all ready and you think you know what you want to talk about. And Charles was up there and he was preaching and about five, maybe a couple of minutes before he finished, man, the Holy Spirit just shifted everything on me and took me from Matthew over to First Peter. And the way the message was presented, it just overlapped what Charles had already talked about. And it was, I remember talking about God wants you to admit your name. He wants you to admit that you're a murderer. He wants you to admit so he could change your name and change who you are and change your heart. And I remember saying, if you're a liar, he wants you to say you're a liar. If you're a murderer, if you're a homosexual. And when I said homosexual, I looked right at this dude that was across the way. And I had no idea I was fixing to say that. And afterwards, the guy came up to me and just bawling and crying. You could tell he was as hurt. He said, I've been battling with this, and I don't know what to do about it. And we prayed with him, and you just felt a sense of peace that came over him. So, you know, it's like God not only puts us where he wants us in the prisons, but he puts us in front of the right person in the prison.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes, he does.
But that's just one of the praise reports. But so what we're going to do real quick, we're going to take a quick commercial break, guys, and listen to a little song, because, you know, everything that you've been through, that we've all been through, that was just the devil lying to us, you know,
yes,
just
was.
Telling us a liar. So I love this song. It's by Zach Williams, Fear is a Liar. So we're going to take a quick break, guys. And hopefully the song's going to start here in a second.
When he told you you're not good enough, when he told you you're not right, when he told you you're not strong enough to put up a good fight, when he told you you're not worthy, when he told you you're not loved, when he told you you're not beautiful, you'll never be enough.